So as mentioned, I kind of do stuff on the web. I've been doing stuff on the web for over 20 years, which makes me very old. It also means that I kind of predate CSS. And that's kind of relevant because my aim in this short presentation is to introduce the major layout methods that we have on the web today, because really for the first time, we've got a proper layout system for the web. And I'm not going to so much talk about the individual specifications, the sort of big name specifications you might have heard of, things like Flexbox and Grid. I'm going to look at some of the things behind those, some of the things that tie those specs together. Because a lot of the questions I'm getting are, you know, should I use Flexbox for this? Should I use Grid? And I think actually there's a different way of looking at this. So we have been talking a lot about Flexbox and Grid recently. I've been writing a lot about them both. We've also got other specifications. We've got things like multiple column layout, which I'm co-editor of that spec. And of course, we've still got things like floats and positioning, which are still perfectly relevant and when used for kind of their proper purposes. But there's something more. In the past, layout was kind of this sort of series of hacks. We'd all sort of worked out, you know, how to line up floats. They looked a bit like a grid and all the different little hacks that we've been using. Our new layout systems are tied together by these sort of core specifications, and we've got box alignment, intrinsic and extrinsic sizing, logical properties and values, and these things underpin the layout systems that we've now got, and really anything that is to come. And so I think the biggest challenge in understanding new layout specs like Flexbox and Grid isn't about understanding the properties that are part of Flexbox and Grid. It's actually changing the way we think about layout and changing the way we think about this system that we now have. So if we start with Flexbox, now this spec was designed to lay things out in a single dimension. So that means as a row or as a column, not both at once. A row in Flexbox relates to the writing mode of the document. So if I've got three items and they're laid out in a single line, I add display flex, and the initial values of Flexbox start to take effect. So the items display as a row, and they start at the start edge according to the document writing mode. So this is a row in a left to right, top to bottom language. The items are all starting on the left, and they progress along to the right. And all we need is this little bit of code to make it so. But if my writing mode for the document, or just for that component, was a vertical writing mode, then the default direction of row would display the items one below the other. So the value of row for flex direction is always along the row of text of that writing mode. Therefore, flex direction column will cause your main axis to run down the block dimension in your writing mode. So you end up with something like this. So the reason the items all line up at the start of the container is due to the alignment properties. Now they started life in Flexbox, and then they made their way into the box alignment specification. So with the left to right text direction, then the start is on the left. With a right to left text direction, the start is on the right. An alignment in Flexbox is really about the distribution of space. Our items here are taking up less space than they need in order to be displayed, and so the spare space is placed at the end of the row. In this example, I've got two flex containers. Both have justified content flex end, but the second is using vertical RL. So the items are moved to the end of the row, and the spare space is put before them. With justified content space between, the spare space is taken and put between all of the items, with the item at either end flush against the start and end of the container. Again, it doesn't matter what the writing mode is, it works in exactly the same way. In Flexbox, the justified content property is used to align the items on the main axis, so whichever you specified with flex direction. To align things on the cross axis, you use align items, which will align the item inside the flex container relative to the other items in that row or column, so it'll kind of move them up and down against each other. So once again, we're thinking about start and end, not top and bottom and left and right. Meaning that it doesn't matter which writing mode you're using, whether that's for the whole page, you know, that everything's in that writing mode because you're in that language, or if you're using writing modes in a kind of creative way, you're wanting to turn something on its side. Everything kind of works in exactly the same way, which feels quite sort of logical when you're doing it. So we tend to think about Flexbox for groups of items, and that's really what it was designed for. But Flex Layout is currently the best way to center an item horizontally and vertically, something which has been bafflingly difficult to do for most of the time that I've been a web developer. So you need to make your parent a Flex container, and then use justify content and align items to set the thing to center, which centers our box with minimal fuss. So I think Flexbox caused a lot of excitement when it kind of appeared, and I think we all started using it a little bit too early because we started using the vendor prefixed version and then battled with three versions of Flexbox as it kind of moved through the specification process with vendor prefixes. And then we got Grid, and Grid seemed to just kind of appear to most people because it didn't get developed with vendor prefixes after the initial Microsoft version. It was developed hidden away behind a browser flag until it was pretty much ready in all of the browsers, and then it landed all at once. So a very different kind of story. But Grid was designed for two-dimensional layout, and that means laying things out as a row and a column at the same time. So there's a very simple example. I'm creating a grid with three columns and two rows, and my items are going to be placed into the cells created on that grid. So we end up with something like this. Now, if you're using Grid Layout, what you're going to want to do is use the Firefox Grid Inspector, because then we can have a look. We can actually see what our grid looks like and where the items are fitting into the cells. It's really useful. And so if you've started to play around with Grid and you haven't had a look at the Firefox Grid Inspector, then you really should do. It's very much worth your time, particularly once you start to get into more complex grids or doing interesting things with alignment. It really helps you see exactly where that grid is and where the items are and what they're spanning and how you're moving it around an area. I think it's really interesting the stuff that Firefox are actually doing, where Chrome have kind of gone down the performance tools, that sort of line. Firefox seems to be really looking at those tools for designers and the things that help us actually create really great layouts, which I think is really cool and very useful to me every day. And we can see with the grid inspector there, we've sort of turned the grid on its side, we're using vertical RL, it's working in exactly the same way. And those alignment properties that started life in Flexbox and ended up in box alignment, the reason that happened is to give us the ability to use those in grid as well and in other layout methods. So if we've got spare space in the grid container in the inline direction, then we can use justify content to distribute it. If we've got space in the block dimension, we can use align content to distribute it. So here we're distributing the space kind of before and after or in between the grid tracks, in exactly the same way as we use align content to distribute space in between flex items. If we want to align the items actually inside their grid area, then we can use align items and justify items. Again, if we align, we're doing that in the block direction. If we're justifying, we're doing that on the inline direction. So these alignment properties give us this consistent way of aligning things, whether in Flexbox or grid layout, and whether we're in a horizontal or a vertical writing mode. However, with grid, of course, we can cause items to span more than one track. And the line-based placement in grid also respects writing mode. So here I've got two layouts. They're both using grid. One is left to right writing mode, and the other is right to left. The line-based placement shown in the last slide is exactly the same as line one, column-wise. It sort of starts on the left and moves over to the right. And if you're in a right to left direction, then we start on the right and move over to the left. And again, Firefox Grid Inspector puts your line numbers on so you can see how that works. You can see that when you're in a left to right direction, then your line one is on your left. If you're in a right to left, it's on the right. as I mentioned at the start, you know, I've worked with CSS since CSS became a thing. You know, I can remember the arguments against, you know, people like, why would we want to use CSS for our fonts? It's quite easy to put our font tags in line. Why would we want to use CSS for layout? Our tables work perfectly well. I remember all of those arguments, and I've seen how things have progressed to this point where we've actually got, you know, we're very close to having a cohesive system for layout for the very first time. Flexbox and Grid and Multicol all have consistent sizing. So you can create a layout and say, well, I'd like this component to be a flex component because it's one-dimensional. I'd like to use Multicol for this. I'd like to use Grid for this. And they'll all line up. And I've, you know, I'm using that in production right now. It means I can create design systems that work in a very consistent way. And we have what is to come. And this is really why, I guess, you know, why we're here, why we're discussing things in the CSS Working Group at TPAC. We're discussing the next things. We're inventing new CSS. We're solving new problems. One of the things that we've currently been working on is the level 2 of Grid, which contains a feature called Subgrid. And Subgrid, if you've started to use Grid Layout at all, you'll know that Grid only works on the direct children of the Grid container. So if you've got something, if you've got a Grid container and then you've got a list inside it and that list is inside a UL, well, the UL will become a Grid item, but the list items won't. With Subgrid, what we can do is we can say, well, actually, I want not just the direct children, but their children to fall onto the overall Grid, which is going to be very, very useful. So that's what's in the level 2 spec, and the spec's kind of finished, and we're sort of waiting for browser implementations of that now. I went through the spec and kind of wrote up in this article, which is in the resources, I've got a link to at the end of this presentation. I just went through the whole spec and kind of explained how it's going to work. So at the moment, we can't try that out yet. So I've tried to explain how the different parts of Subgrid are going to work. In some of the examples, if you go and look at the examples on CodePen, I'm using logical properties. These are mappings of things like width and height and left and right, so they're sort of flow relative versions, so that if you're using a different writing mode, you're not sort of tied to the dimensions of the screen, everything kind of works properly. And so you can have inline size instead of width, for example, turn your box on the side, and it still sort of all respects the same sizing. So they let us sort of separate the physical dimensions of our screen from the writing mode of the document. And I think generally you'll want a mix of both. Sometimes you want things tied to the screen dimensions. Other times you want things sized according to the writing mode. Again, that's something else I sort of wrote up with a bunch of demos. Support is best at the moment, I think, in Firefox. And all those demos kind of work, and you can play around and see how logical properties and values work. Those box alignment properties I was talking about. We've got implementation of those in Flexbox and Grid, but hopefully soon we're going to see implementation of those in block layout. So maybe in the future you won't have to turn your box into a flex container in order to center something inside it. You'll just be able to use block layout for that. And again, that will make layout on the web more consistent and more reliable and more kind of as expected if you were just coming at this fresh. And then, you know, these are specifications that I've pulled out here that I think are important. I mean, I tend to deal with layout stuff. And there's other things that I've kind of got my eye on that I would love to see in the future. I would love to see something like regions reinvigorated. I'd like to see something like exclusions. But those come from use cases that I see frequently. I'm very interested in the use cases that other people are seeing. What problems have we not yet solved in CSS? What are you having to do in a hacky way that you think it would be great if CSS would just let us do this, rather than having to jump through hoops to get that effect? And anyone can raise issues, and all of the work of the CSS Working Group happens in the open. All of our issues are on GitHub. We do some things like ask various members of the CSS Working Group, we'll ask on Twitter and say, hey, you know, have you got any ideas about this? We're trying to think up the name of that. Do get involved in those discussions, or come and talk to people like me. You know, I'm always interested to hear about the problems you're experiencing and the things that you would like to see happening in CSS, and then I can kind of bring that back to the meetings as feedback for everyone else. So that's my very, very short presentation. All of the code and the examples are at that URL, and I will tweet that out in MO. And I'll be around later if people have got any questions. Thank you very much.